Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuhu, and this is the fourth episode of this series in biological processes in human body. And I am, as you know, Abdul Rahman, and today we'll be looking at the circulatory process in human beings. So this will be our main focus of this session. Right, in this episode we'll be covering circulatory process. Mainly we'll be looking at blood circulation, and then we'll also go into some additional notes regarding lymphatic system that we have in the human body. At the same time we'll look into some of the diseases related to the circulatory system. Right, so the first thing that we are going to look at is the blood composition. So if you take the blood, almost 55% of the blood, half to half, is plasma, which is in a pale yellow color, and then we have the contents in the sense of we call them as corpuscles, which are the platelets, and white blood cells, which we call as leukocytes, and erythrocytes, which are red blood cells. So the reason the blood is red is because of this RBC or red blood cells, or rather the huge number of or the amount of red blood cells that is available within the blood circulatory system. So some of the facts that we should know about blood. First of all, it is a connective tissue. So it is not a muscle or it is not a liquid, but rather it is a tissue. And the special property of this tissue is that it is in a liquid format. So it is able to transport many of the materials in the body, especially transportation of respiratory substances such as oxygen and carbon dioxide, and the end products of, or rather the products that we need, raw materials for respiration, which is glucose. So as you can see from this diagram, it contains plasma and a suspension of corpuscles, which we have given here. So that is what is given in this ratio. Now let us look, or let us rather have a overall view of the blood that we have. So the blood comprises of corpuscles and plasma, and if you take the corpuscles that we have, we can divide them into RBC or red blood cells and white blood cells or WBC. So if you take the white blood cell, we can further divide them into two groups as granulocytes and non-granulocytes. So granulocytes, there are mainly three types. We have more than that, but anyway, neutrophils, eosinophils and basophils. And in non-granulocytes, we have monocytes and lymphocytes. So this is what, or this is rather a rough composition of the blood that we have. So first of all, let us look at red blood cells. Now if you take red blood cells, we can see that it is in a large number. So if you take 1 cubic millimeter of blood, we have around 5 million red blood cells. So because of this large or vast number only, that we find the blood to be red in color. And secondly, from this image also you can see that it has a sort of disc shape, and it is biconcave. You might have studied about concave and convex in your optical lesson, right? Optics, have you studied about them? Yes, good, right. So this have a sort of a concave shape, and you can look at those shape from this diagram as well. And it is produced in the bone marrow, or rather the red bone marrow to be exact, and it can last around 4 months. So every 4 months it will regenerate. That means it will be destroyed and new red blood cells have to be made. So it doesn't happen every 4 months, but rather each cell will have a lifespan of around 4 months. Now you can see that because of this shape, or this disc shape and this concave shape, which is biconcave, we cannot find any nucleus in this RBC or erythrocytes. The reason that we don't have nucleocyte is, which actually advantages for us, because it has a pigment by the name of hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is the pigment in RBC that is responsible for transporting oxygen within the blood circulatory system. So it can bind with oxygen that we get from respiration in when it goes through the respiratory system, or in rather when we studied about respiratory process in one of our previous lessons, you can revise that as well. In that we studied in the respiratory surface, or through that oxygen can diffuse into blood, and when it diffuses into blood it can bind with hemoglobin pigments. So when it binds with hemoglobin, it becomes oxyhemoglobin. So that is one of the main functions of RBC. So RBC is very important so to transport oxygen. Now let us look at the other stuff, which is white blood cells. If you take WBC, white blood cells are not as much as in number that you can find in as RBC. So RBC, we found how much or how many RBC were there in 1 cubic millimeter. It was around 5 million, right? If you want, we can just go back and see. Around 5 million RBC. But here we have between 4,000 to 11,000 white blood cells. So this, the characteristic of WBC is almost all WBC, all the types of white blood cells are larger than red blood cells. And it is produced in bone marrow. It has nucleus. And it is colorless. It doesn't have a color. That is why we call it as white blood cells. And I don't know why we call it as white blood cells. But anyway, it is colorless. And the ratio of RBC to WBC is 600 to 1. So for every 600 RBC, there is one WBC or white blood cell. Now, if we take the white blood cells, we spoke about two types. One of them being granulocytes and the other one being non-granulocytes. So in granulocytes, you can see that we have three varieties. One of them is known as neutrophils. So a photo of neutrophil is given to you, and it has a circular shape, a spherical shape to be exact, and it also has nuclei that you can see, and the nucleus has a characteristic shape. It is convoluted and it has sort of lumps in it. And eosinophils, it is also a type of granulocytes. The reason why we call it as granulocytes is because of the granules that we find within these cells. We can you see small dots within these cells? Yeah, that is the reason we call them as granulocytes, because we have a large number of granules within them. Within WBC, neutrophils constitute around 50 to 70% of WBC, and we have 1 to 4% of eosinophils, and basophils we have around 0 to 1%. So it is a very minute amount, the ratio. And non-granulocytes, we have two of them. One is lymphocytes, the other one is monocyte. We can see there are some granules in these as well. But compared to granulocytes, the number of small particles or granules within these cells is less. So comparatively, it is very low, or sometimes it might be absent. So we can see that lymphocytes make around 20 to 40% of WBC, and monocytes can make up to 2 to 8% of WBC or white blood cells. Now let us look at the functions of white blood cells. One of the main function is phagocytosis. Destroy the infectious particle by phagocytosis. Let us look at this diagram so that it might be very easy for us to understand. So we can see, first of all, when a bacterium enters in, it will be received by the particular cells that we are going to do, and finally the output will be, it will be excreted, or exocytosis, it will be excreted as soluble debris. That means it will start to break off, phagosomes will form, and phagosomes will be attacked by lysosomes, and these lysosomes are the people who are like a troop of army or an army of soldiers. They come and attack, and finally they will go back as soluble debris. So this is where by engulfing an organism or engulfing some sort of a particle, that particle can be destroyed by white blood cells. So this is what we call as phagocytosis. And the second one is they can destroy by production of antibodies. So antibodies also can help in destruction of or removal of these particles. So they also can disable the bacteria or some pathogens that enter in our body. Now let us look at the composition of blood plasma, right? First of all, let me zoom into this particular photo. Can you you can see this photo, right? Is this photo clear to you? In what color is it? Is it in red color? No, it's not red. It is rather, as you said, yellow or pale yellow. So plasma actually is not red color, and we spoke that characteristic red color is given to blood because of RBC. Now this is blood plasma. Blood plasma has lot of soluble and non-soluble stuff. Almost 92% of this blood plasma is water, and then we have around 1 or 2% of proteins. In proteins we have albumin, and we might have globulin and fibrinogen. Then we can see that some of the nutrients may be present there, including monosaccharides, amino acids, vitamins, glycerol, and some ions such as bicarbonate, calcium, potassium, sodium, and the waste products due to in liver protein synthesis, such as urea, uric acid, and some gases, respiratory gases also might be available, and hormones, which are important for chemical balance and homeostasis, antibodies and antigens. These things might be present in plasma. But the highest constituent or the particular stuff that is in blood plasma the most is water, which is around 90 to 93 to 94%. So we have a large amount of water, and the rest of them are smaller particles. They can be soluble particles and also water insoluble particles. Right. Now let us look at the main functions of the blood. The first one is transportation. We earlier spoke that blood is a connective tissue. So, and it is in liquid format, and hence it is able to act as a medium of transport. So some stuff such as respiratory gases, oxygen, carbon dioxide, these things can be transported. Digested end products, they also can be transported. Then excretory substances such as urea, uric acid, we can transport them as well. Mineral ions, as we saw, like potassium ions, sodium bicarbonate, these things also can be transported. And for chemical coordination, we can transport hormones as well, and proteins are also available. The second thing is to protect our body, and we use two methods, which is phagocytosis and antibodies. Now can you tell me which particle or which constituent of the blood is important for protection of body? Is it white blood cell, red blood cell, or plasma? It's actually white blood cell, because as we saw earlier, white bloods are the sort of army that we have in our body. Then to maintain chemical coordination, which we will study in another chapter, and homeostasis, which also will be there. But just to make a small clarity, homeostasis simply means that maintaining the internal environment of our body in a balanced state, even though the outer environment might change. So we will go into that in detail in our next episode. Right. Now let's look at how blood circulation works. First of all, let us look at some of the facts you might have studied in your previous grades, that how the heart is and what are the functions of the heart and what is the structure of the heart. Anyway, let us just zoom in to the heart and see what is given here. Now, as you can see, our heart comprises of four sort of rooms, and we have two atria and two ventricles, and both atria and ventricles, they are important and they start pumping blood. And we can see that from this particular diagram, we have different types of blood entering into the heart and leaving the heart. That means we have non-oxygenated blood which enters into the heart through this superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, and finally the oxygenated blood will leave the through aorta to the other parts of the body. Now, we have studied about this particular circulation in one of the earlier chapters that we did. Earlier chapters in the sense, in one of your early grades, maybe you studied about this in grade 9, right? The blood circulation and heart. Yes, you might have studied that and you might remember that. But anyway, just to summarize, the blood circulation unit has a central pump in humans, which we call as heart, and a set of vessels. So these vessels or these tubular structures are can be called as arteries, veins, and I did not write the third one, which is capillaries, blood capillaries. So arteries, all the arteries will carry oxygenated blood, blood which is rich in oxygen, except the pulmonary artery, which will carry blood to the lungs. And secondly, all the veins will carry deoxygenated blood, or blood which is very low in oxygen, except the pulmonary vein, which will carry oxygenated blood. And you know, this pulmonary vein means the vein that comes from lungs towards the heart. So that is why it carries oxygenated blood. Anyway, you can see from this diagram about the arteries and veins, and the particular color help us to understand what sort of blood is there. For example, let me zoom into that as well. We can see that the arteries are given in red color and the veins are given in blue color. So we told the arteries carry oxygenated blood and veins will carry deoxygenated blood. I hope that you can remember the properties of arteries and veins in one of your grade 9 lessons, right? Right, since that you have the idea of what veins are and what arteries are and capillaries are, we don't have to discuss that again in this lesson, and you can just revise your grade 9 book for further details. Anyway, right. Now let us look at double blood circulation and what that is. Before going into the details of that, let me take you into this particular picture that I have given here. In which case, as you can see, the blood actually flows through the heart twice when it completes one cycle through the body. That means when you take the heartbeat, first of all, it will pump the blood. Just to make it in a sequence, I am using first and second. It will pump blood to the lungs, and then lungs will return the blood, which means oxygenated blood, back to the heart, and that will be pumped back throughout the body. So to make clear, first it will be coming into an artery. Through an artery, it will just reach the main heart chambers, and one chamber is the ventricle, and with the right ventricle, it will be pumped into the heart, pumped from the heart towards the lungs. And in lungs, as you can see, the blood becomes red color, or in other words, just to make it clear, it becomes oxygenated, and it will come back through the pulmonary vein back to the left atrium. And from left atrium, it will go into the left ventricle, and from there it will be pumped throughout the body via aorta. As you can see, when one cycle of this particular blood circulation is completed in the body, it can go two times in the sense the heart will pump blood twice, because it has to pump the blood to the lungs and throughout the body as well. So that is why we call it as double blood circulation. That means blood will flow through the heart twice when it circulates the body once. So what are these two types of circulation? As you can see, we can call them as pulmonary circulation and systemic circulation. Pulmonary circulation is where blood flows through the lungs. For this process, the right ventricle that you can see here, the one that is given in blue color, this right ventricle will act as the main pump. And for systemic circulation, or the circulation that happens throughout the body, the blood flows through all the organs except the lungs, and in this case the main pump will be the left ventricle. So that is why we hear that lubbed up sound, where we have two contractions. So if you take this GIF, you can see that. So if you take this particular GIF or animation that I have given you, you can see from that the heart and how it pumps. You can see that there is a contraction and then there is a relaxation as well. Actually, there are two contractions that happens here. That is why we can hear a lubbed up sound, because of closing of the valves. Anyway, we are discussing about heartbeat now. The heartbeat has a characteristic sound which we call as lubbed up sound. So in a minute there can be 72 beats. So for a healthy male or healthy female or a healthy human being, there can be 72 beats per minute. So this is the average value. So the heartbeat, or the beat, or the sound that we get, is due to the contraction and dilation of the heart muscles. Because it contracts and relaxes, that is the sound that we get. So what is the characteristic sound that we get in the heart? What do we call this sound? Yeah, lubbed up. So that is why I have given this to you within inverted commas, right? Now let us look at the cardiac cycle and ECG, right? So cardiac cycle is where it consists of three parts. The first one being the contraction of atria, and then contraction of ventricles, and then the relaxation of atria and ventricle. So the heart will contract the atria first, that means the top chambers of the heart will contract first, and then it takes around 0.1 seconds to do that for one contraction. We call that as diastole, and it is denoted as P. And then the contraction of ventricles is known as systole. It will also take 0.1 second. And after that, after both of them contract only, the heart will start to relax. So the relaxation process can take up to 0.4 seconds, and that is given as T. So we have given you an ECG, or rather a labeled ECG, electrocardiogram of the cardiac cycle, so for us to understand. So since you are still in grade level, we are not going to go into detail. We'll just go through some of the facts only. So the contraction of atria is given in this hike. So what is the title, or what is the label that we have given to this particular hike? What letter denotes this one? The letter P, right? The letter P is denoted here. And from this we can see that it takes around 0.1 seconds. You can see the duration is around 0.1 seconds. We can see the duration here. Right, okay. And now is it clear? Please hold on. Right, I think it might be clear now. Okay, right. So, and the second one is QRS. QRS stands for systole, or contraction of ventricles. So this also takes roughly around 1 second, as they say, but you can see from the graph actually it takes more than 1 second, but it's okay. It takes around 1 second. And the next one we call as T is the relaxation of atria and ventricle. This whole segment will take around 0.4 seconds. So you don't have to go through all these details for your grade 11 syllabus. You just have to know what are the parts of cardiac cycle, and what is diastole, systole, and intervening or complete relaxation. And the times also might be important when you are doing your multiple choice questions, right? Okay. Anyway. Now let us come into more practical beams. We are going to discuss about blood pressure. So blood pressure is actually not just one, but rather there are two blood pressure. One we call as systolic blood pressure, as you can see here, and the other one we call it as diastolic blood pressure. So systolic blood pressure is where when the blood is pumped into arteries from the heart, that particular high pressure is known as systolic blood pressure. So pressure in the arteries when blood is injected into it is what we mean by systolic blood pressure. So if we measure that, it will be around 110 to 120 millimeters of mercury. So that amount of pressure is exerted onto the walls of arteries. Diastolic blood pressure is when the heart beat or the heart relaxes. When the heart relax, no blood will be pumped into arteries. So that is what we mean by the pressure in the arteries within or in between the heartbeats. So between the heartbeat, you can see the heart will start to relax. It will take around 0.4 seconds. So at that time, the pressure will be lower. So it will be between 70 to 80 millimeters of mercury. So the normal resting pressure we can write for an adult as 120 to 80 millimeters of mercury. So once again, that pressure can be divided into two as systolic and diastolic. Systolic blood pressure is when the pressure exerted on the arteries when blood is ejected, pumped to it. Diastolic is where the pressure in the arteries when the heart is resting or in between the heartbeat. You got the concept, right? Okay. Yes, it's possible. As you said, when the pressure increases, it is possible that some of the veins and arteries can be damaged, and it can lead to some other problems, as you have mentioned. So it's very true. We will look into that as well and what causes them as well. Okay. Right. Now we look at the main factors that can increase blood pressure. So the main factors that can increase blood pressure are, one is age. The more you grow older, the chances of you having blood pressure is also high. So a person who is 10 years old might not have a higher chance of blood pressure as a person who is 60 years old, because the more you age, our body becomes it becomes older, it ages, so the elasticity within the tubes and arteries, they decreases. So it happens with age. And the second one is sex or gender. You being male or female is another factor that can affect the blood pressure. One of the most important things that can affect a person's blood pressure is their mentality. If you have a highly stressful work or if you have a very stressful mentality, it can have a huge impact in hiking up the blood pressure of a person. So we should have a cool mentality. So if the workload or environment is stressful, it can cause a high blood pressure or increase our blood pressure as well. And finally, diseases also play an important role in increasing the blood pressure. It may be related to the circulatory system or it may not be related to circulatory system. Sometimes you might have a disease which is not related to the circulatory system at all, but still it can impact the blood pressure or the increase of it. Right. Now, before we go, ask. The heart fails, right? Swelling of the heart, right? You're asking about that. Right. Let us look at why that happens. Yeah, go on. Okay, you want to know why the heart swells. We'll try to find it out in the end of the lesson, or I'll just give you a personal message as to why it happens, right, later. Okay, right. Human lymphatic system. Now we spoke about the system of nerve, system of arteries and veins, and then we have heart. So this particular active process is what we call as the blood, human blood circulatory system. Now we speak about the lymphatic system and why we need it. First of all, we already have a blood circulatory system, and why do you think we need a lymphatic system? Why do you think we need an extra system? In simple words or in one word? Yeah, simple as that. It will facilitate circulation, or it will be like our backup system. So backup may not be the correct term, but rather it is like a supportive system. What happens is, now if you take the blood cells, what happens in blood, not only blood cells but in blood, when it goes to the capillaries, we understood that earlier in one of our lessons, that some particles can diffuse through. So when some particles can diffuse through, for example, we can see that plasma and some of the cells can diffuse into the particular cell area from the blood. But the blood will keep moving around. Now after it diffuses out of the cell, it may not be able to come back. So whatever the fluid that diffuses out of the blood circulation system is known as tissue fluid. So this tissue fluid, what happens is after it is used, or if it get into a sort of its own work, finally it may not be able to come back. Come back means it may not be able to join back the circulatory system. So at that time only this lymphatic system will come into work. So lymphatic system, actually according to the clevelandclinic.org, is a network of tissues, or it can be vessels and organs, and they work together. They work together so that they can move a colorless watery fluid, which now we call as lymph, back into the circulatory system or our bloodstream. So to do this, they have two main ducts, which is the thoracic duct and the right lymphatic duct, you can see here. And there are some organs which help. For example, the spleen is an organ that can help, and there are some various nodes within our body that we can see, especially around the liver and spleen and stuff like that, that can help to put back or collect all this stuff. So what happens is, when we move our legs and hands and stuff like that, this liquid will be moved. Due to the pressure difference and our movement, they can move into different nodes, and finally they can collect into the thoracic duct, and it will be sent back to our main system, which is the circulatory system. So as there are some vessels in the circulatory system, which is the blood system that we have, here also we have some vessels. We call them as lacteals, capillaries and nodes. So they can transport lymph and they can store lymph as well. Now as you can see, as due to diffusion, white blood cells can diffuse into cells from the blood. So white blood cells are also a part of lymph, because as it goes through the blood circulatory system, when the need arises, white blood cells along with plasma can diffuse out of the capillaries, and they can enter into the lymphatic system. So when they are in the lymphatic system, if there is some infection, they can fight the infection as well. So because of these white blood cells, they are able to fight infectious organisms. In your syllabus, lymphatic system does not have a major role, but you should have to know some facts regarding lymphatic system, okay? Right, okay. Now finally, we'll go through the diseases associated with blood circulatory system that we have, and these are the main diseases that is given to you in your syllabus, grade 11 science syllabus. First of all, we are going to look at atherosclerosis. So atherosclerosis is a condition that is caused by atheroma. So what is atheroma is, now in simple words, what happens is, when we start consuming high amount of low density lipids, that means when we start consuming cholesterol and foods that have high amount of cholesterol, most of these cholesterol materials, what they constitute is highly saturated fatty acids. So unsaturated, saturated, there are two types, but just for reason's sake, let's consider there are some saturated fatty acids and cholesterol is there. When you consume more and more cholesterol, what happens is they can deposit in arteries. How can they deposit in arteries? The reason is this: cholesterol is water insoluble. So when it has to go through the blood, it has to be converted to lipoproteins. So there are two types of lipoprotein. One is HDL, high density lipoproteins, and LDL, which is low density lipoproteins. These low density lipoproteins, what they can do is they can deposit themselves in arteries. So when they can deposit themselves in arteries, this condition is known as atheroma, or in our words we call this as high cholesterol. We say that, okay, he has cholesterol. When we say he has cholesterol or she has cholesterol, it means that particular person has atheroma. That condition is known as atherosclerosis. Now what happens is, due to this cholesterol, the arteries that power or that supply blood to the heart, not from the heart or to the heart, but that supply blood to the heart, that means for the heart muscles to work, we call them as coronary arteries. These are the arteries that are just on top of the heart, and they provide the heart with necessary blood, especially oxygenated blood, so that the heart muscles can contract and relax. So what happens is, if this condition happens within the heart, we might get a pain known as angina pain. So angina pain is when you can see that sometimes people will just hold their heart and they will sit down, telling that they have a sort of a heart attack. So this angina pain can result in heart failure if the block is not cleared or if it is not looked into. So because of this, we can or experience heart failure as well. So this is a very serious condition, and high cholesterol, that is why they say for the patients who have high cholesterol, they should take care of their body and take care of their heart and do exercises regularly, reduce the amount of oil that you take. So these lots and lots of advices are given to them so that they may prevent atherosclerosis condition, or rather they may reduce it. So another condition that can happen is hypertension and hypotension. Now similarly, what happens is, hypertension is where, due to LDL deposit, as we discussed earlier, the walls of arteries might experience a very high pressure. So when we have high pressure within this artery wall, we call this as hypertension. So the reason why we have so much of pressure into the arteries or the walls of arteries, because when you have low density lipids and when they deposit within these walls of arteries, the heart has to work more and more to supply enough blood to our system. So as the heart has to overwork, what happens is this particular will create a very high pressure within the circulatory system. So when we measure using a stethoscope and when we check the blood pressure and stuff like that through the machines that we have, we will find that it is above the normal value because of this hypertension. Now hypotension also can occur, and one more thing, hypertension can occur when you become very old and the elasticity of the blood vessels reduces. When the arteries are not as elastic as they were before, what happens is it also can cause hypertension. The next thing that we are going to look at is hypotension. Hypotension is where the pressure of the wall on arteries, there is a low pressure or there is a pressure drop on the wall of arteries. This is not a very serious condition, but rather this is a condition that occurs that is due to the lack of nutrients, to be exact. So when we take some vitamins or minerals that is there, and it can be cured very soon as well. This condition can be reversed very soon. Now thrombosis. This is one of the very severe problems that can affect us. Thrombosis is a block in blood supply due to blood clotting. So if there's a clot in the blood supply, we call this as thrombosis. So thrombosis can happen to any organ in the body. For example, if it happens to the brain, it's a very serious condition. This can cause paralysis. So paralysis is a condition where the blood supply to the brain is blocked by a very, very minute clot. So if one small minute clot is there and we are unable to remove it, it might cause paralysis. Most of the time, we might have to do some operations, or we might have to do some treatment or take some drugs. Whatever happens, this is a very serious condition. Now, if the block is to the coronary, ask away. You ask something, right? Blood stroke. It's clot, right? Clot means like a small, how do I put it? Clot is like a small block, yes. Yes, blood clot. Now, I don't say that paralysis can only be caused by thrombosis, but what I mean by here is thrombosis can also cause paralysis. There might be many reasons for paralysis, but thrombosis may be one of the reasons of paralysis. Because if the thrombosis is there in the coronary arteries, the arteries which supply blood to the heart, it is highly possible that we might get a heart attack because there is not enough blood to the heart. The heart cannot work, so it will go into panic mode. So the main reasons of thrombosis may be alcohol and soda, which is very prominent, and consuming large amount of saturated fatty acid non-stop, like short eats and different types of meat, non-stop consideration. And if you have a very low fiber diet, we spoke about why fiber diet is very important for us early in digestive lesson. And if we take very high amount of salt, and we are sort of how do I put it, square, or we have a high amount of body weight and we don't do much of exercise, we are very lazy and we are very lethargic, sitting down all the time. And if we also have a very high stress level, it may be due to family problems or it may be due to some other problems that we have, workload. So if we have some sort of an issue like this, we call this as thrombosis. So that is the end of our lesson for today. Do you have any questions regarding this lesson? Okay, inshallah, then shall we end the lesson then? Okay.